Amen. Thank you. As Pastor Pauline pointed out, we have some special guests here, and I'd like to have them come up, David and Lydia Martinez. They're just going to share just for a minute with us. If you don't know David and Lydia, they are missionaries to Orphanage Emmanuel in Honduras. They have a small, struggling work of about 500 kids they minister to, and they've came out of Oxnard, and we've supported them for, and you guys have supported them with short-term mission trips and prayer and finances for years and years and years. And they're just you know, some of the most blessed couple I've ever come in contact with. And I want you to listen to what they have to say, because they are anointed of Jesus Christ, and they're awesome people.
Well, we want to thank you for all that you've done. You know, the songs we were singing about, the power of Jesus, the power of God. You know, it's so true. And we see it so much every day in Honduras. You know, for the last 10 years, I mean, we just had a big breakthrough. I had my Goliath over there that was attacking in Honduras for the last 10 years. We had 10 years ago well-intended politicians who went to the orphanage and they were moved emotionally to the children, and they said, "What can we do for you to help you?" And we said, "Well, if you could cut out our energy bill, that would be wonderful." Yeah. And they said, "Okay, you don't pay anymore." So we didn't pay anymore. But nothing was in writing. We just took their word for it. And the years went on and years went on. And then we kept going to the government. "Well, when are you going to give us something in writing?" "Well, just don't pay nothing. Don't worry," and all this. Well, this new administration came in and said, "If you don't pay up all your past debt, we're going to shut you down." And, I mean, we battled and battled for the last, well, 10 years, but the last 3 years were a nightmare for me, having to trust and believe in God that he was going to come through somehow. They wanted $1.5 million. We said, we don't have it. So, well, we'll just shut you down. And in December of this last year, this congresswoman came just to see the children with her bodyguards and entourage and all that. She came, and the little babies and all the little kids came out. They hugged her and just loved her up like our kids always when we have visitors. And the lady said, "I know about your problem, and I will do something." This was the first week of December. And we thought, yeah, just another promise. Well, December 15th, she fought against her own people, the government, and they put the $1.5 million in the government budget for the government to pay for it, and they made it a bill. Congress passed it, and we have 15 copies to prove that we're okay. We're debt-free. Many of you here knew about that situation and were interceding for us. And we thank you. God heard your prayers, and he answered them. And we thank Pastor Larry, Pastor Jerry, their families. We thank all of you, the South Coast Fellowship family. For those of you that have gone to Emmanuel and have ministered to the children, they've left their footprint in your heart. And we pray for you, and please continue to pray for us. We have these children that nobody wants. The families don't want, the government doesn't want them, they throw them out. We have a little 12-year-old girl who's been with us a month that the mother was giving drugs and prostituting her out. She's only 12 years old, and she doesn't understand. And she's having a hard time there at Emmanuel, wondering like, what's going on. We have a little baby. They brought us a newborn baby. We got to name him. He weighed 3 pounds when he got there. Now he weighs 4. So we have a lot of children that need your prayers.
Amen.
And
that's
we thank you. We thank you for all you do. And like Jerry said, you support us in prayer and finances. Some of you go down there and continue to do so. Well, we thank you and we appreciate you and we love you all. We really do.
Good morning. Good morning, Pastor Pauline. Well, for David, it was his Goliath. For me, it was the parting of my Red Sea. You know, I'm sure many of you can relate. You know, there's times when you're being chased by the devil, and You don't know why. He just keeps bombarding you. He keeps after you. He stops. He changes his mind. You think he has stopped. You let down your guard. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord, right? Wham! Here he comes again. Mm-hmm. It's just the way the enemy works. But for me, it was you guys saying everything here. It was just to show God who he was and that he's still doing miracles. The hindrance is we don't believe that he will do it for us.
That's right.
And it's not to get into a situation where you don't have the faith and that's not why you're healed. No. I'm throwing that out. Because God says if you have the faith of a mustard seed, it's almost nothing. But if you just cry out to him and you believe that he will do it, he will do it.
Amen. That's right.
The thing is, he doesn't tell you when and how. Amen. And that's the hard part for all of us. It took 10 years. And when I would ask the Lord and pray about the situation, he would just tell me, I'm the light. I mean, hello? You know, he always speaks to me that way. I talk too much, so when I stop, he gives me a couple of words so I will listen. He said, I'm the light. And so one afternoon, David was sharing this with somebody in front of our house. And then it came to me. I said, Lord, names and numbers always had a significance in the Bible. And so I thought, well, 7 I know, 3 I know. There's not too many I know. But what does 10 mean? And so I was thinking to myself what the Lord had done, and I said, this is a lot of money. I have no idea how much money. I just know that it's a lot. And when you say it in their money, it sounds even more. It says 32 million lempiras. I mean, yeah, what is that? And so the Holy Spirit would show me. He goes, look, Lydia, it's like this. In your past, you sinned 32 million times, and I forgave you. And if you sin today, I would forgive you and erase that. And for your future sins, I will erase that. I have forgiven you for everything. And so then, praise you, Jesus. I said, oh, now I understand, and started to cry and to weep. And so I looked on the internet. And it said three things. It said testimony, it said law, and responsibility. I said, Lord, the testimony is you, what you've done here, of your power, of your greatness, of who you are. And it is law, an act of God and an act of Congress. It is law. The responsibility that we have is to continue with that monies to put into the ministry, to put into the children.
Amen.
And I
meant,
after that, it was so much confirmation. I just continued to cry and give Lord the glory. So I want to thank you, like David says, for all of your prayers and support. And I'm sure if all the missionaries could be here, they would say the same thing. They would say thank you for your faithfulness to God, for taking us in.
Amen.
And you know,
that's right.
A lot of us, we are successful because of God.
Amen.
We are successful because we have made a lot of mistakes. And we have tried not to make them anymore. And we're at the feet of God in his mercy.
Amen.
But we need you.
Yes.
You have come down and loved us up. You have been there to pray and intercede. And it wasn't important that we knew then, but the Holy Spirit and God knew that and has carried us through this far.
Amen.
So God bless each and every one of you. And thank you so very much, because we are a witness to the power of God,
that's
what you
right.
were singing today.
Amen.
Thank
that's
you.
That's exactly right.
Thank you.
Amen. That'll work. I just preached my sermon there. Woo! Very good. Awesome. Well, that is so great. You guys are awesome. And we'll continue. We're going to continue to support and pray for you guys and make a difference around the world. That's what we're about. If you notice, Pastor Larry is not here. He's around the world making a difference. He is in Chile right now. And he, I spoke to him last night. He sends greetings to everybody, and he's going to be on a plane tomorrow to come home. So be praying for him as he flies back. He was went to Peru and also Chile. As you guys know, we're participating in the Surge Project, which has planted many, many churches in both those countries. And he was able to go to a big conference down there for all of South America and Central America, and then was able to touch all the churches that you guys helped plant. And if you got on Facebook, you probably saw that about three or four of the churches in Chile have actually, they call themselves South Coast Fellowship, whatever the city is. And obviously it's just a name, but what a blessing and what an awesome thing to think about that you guys are making impacts by your giving, by your prayers, all around the world, whether it be Honduras or Chile or Peru or wherever. God is using us to transform lives and see people's lives changed. And what a blessing that we can partner with our brothers and sisters all around the world and see lives changed by the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so anyway, that's where he's at, and he'll be back, obviously, next weekend. Let's go ahead and pray before we get in the Word here. Heavenly Father, we're thankful, Lord, for this time to fellowship and just experience you, Lord. And we're thankful, Lord, that we're going to hear what we need to hear today, Lord. And you're going to speak through us, Lord, to be able to allow you, Holy Spirit, to speak into our lives, Lord. We empty ourselves out, and we're going to listen, Lord, and we're going to, from your word, Lord, glean what we need to hear, Lord, because it is a power of salvation, Lord. It is the everything that we need, Lord, encompassed in you, Lord. And so we look to you right now, Lord. I believe that each person here is going to walk out of this place changed because of their touch with you, Lord Jesus. And we're believing for that, and we're thankful, Lord, for this time to be able to be here and celebrate and worship with our brothers and sisters and with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to continue in our series called Increasing in Knowledge of God. And as you can see, the verse that we've been studying throughout this first part of the year is Colossians 1:10. We took a number of weeks and talked about walking in a manner worthy of the Lord, how we need to get our lives in right order so we can be good Christians and walk in what God has called us to do. And then next we talked about bearing fruit. Obviously, we need to bear fruit. If we're Christians, we need to see the fruit happen in our lives. And as we kind of finish this up, we're going to be talking about increasing in the knowledge of God. Obviously, hopefully all of us have received Jesus Christ as our Savior here in this room. If you haven't, please today, don't leave this room without making that choice, because it's the greatest decision you'll ever make to start. But for the rest of us, we need to increase in the knowledge of God. It's great that you received Jesus Christ, but you need to understand who God is, what he encompassed, what he can do, what he's given us. And we only get that through the Word of God and by experiencing his revelation in our lives. And what I want to talk about today is the power of God. And we've already kind of talked about it through worship and through David and Lydia and what have you. We've seen that. And I just want you for a minute just to kind of step out of yourself and think about who God is and what kind of power that he actually has. Because I think a lot of times we look at our circumstances, we look at God through our filters, through our experience, through what we think is reality. And that's not really who God is. Because God is the creator of the universe. He is indescribable. He is just so immense that maybe even my little brain, I can't totally figure it out, but I need to get my brain out of it and look to Jesus Christ and look to God and increase my knowledge of him and understand just how incredible he is. Because as Pastor Pauline was praying that over your health, over your finances, do I believe God has enough power for that? Do I believe my God is big enough to take care of $1.5 million? Do I really believe that? Do I think that in my mind? And it goes back to me understanding the love of my Father. And a lot of us have been filtered by our fathers, by people we've come in contact with, by our experiences, by what we've seen, by where we've been, what we've done. And we've allowed God to be filtered through that. And we need to expand our thinking. We need to, as Isaiah said, push our tent stakes out. And we need to quit looking at ourselves and look to God. Because I'm here to tell you, his word says he is bigger. He is bigger than anything you're going to face. He has the power to empower you to tackle anything in your life. And I want you to just look at a video. It's probably not going to do as good a job as what David and Lydia just did. But it just talks about how God is just indescribable. And it's by a guy named Louis Giglio, who's a prominent minister. And a guy named Chris Tomlin just kind of wrote the score of this. So watch this real quick. It's only a couple minutes, and we'll talk about it.
John Glenn reports he is ready. This is Mercury Control.
If he's ready, so are we. We'll stand by, even as you, watching the picture, seeing what transpires.
The ignition sequence starts. Engines on. 5, 4, 3, 2. All engines running. Launch commit. Liftoff. We have liftoff 49 minutes past the hour.
One who created all those stars. That just always strikes me. More stars than the sand in this world. There's more. Just think about that. We have one little star in our galaxy. Wow. That's a God we serve. And that's how big God is. He is indescribable, but his power is immense. And yet we limit it. We don't think he's big enough. But he is. And I want to look at just a couple examples out of the book of Acts about what God's power really means. I want to read Acts chapter 1, verse 8. It'll be up on the screens. You can turn there if you have your Bibles. This is Jesus talking to his disciples. Paul's recounting it. And we're all disciples, right? So this applies to us. And it says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And that word power just jumps out to me. And I think about that, and I'm kind of in awe of that. So here's your first fill-in, is what is this power? Wes talked about the three kind of different words for power in the Bible. This word is the word dunamis. And if you look on your notes, I've kind of put on there what dunamis means. I'm just going to read it to you. And it says, this is godly explosive power or ability. Explosive ability. The ability to produce a strong effect. Might. Strong might. And it's supernatural manifestations of power, of miracles, of wonders, of powerful deeds. We get our words dynamite, dynamo, dynamic. This is not like just like a little pipsqueak word, right? We're talking explosive. We're talking supernatural power. We're talking large. We're not talking small. You know, it's not Rhode Island, it's Texas here. We're talking big. And we need to tap into that power. Because our God is big. And He didn't call you to small. He called you to big. I know Dave and Lydia, when they first were called down there, I'm sure they never envisioned having 550 kids or whatever they have. But they're doing a big work down there. And they're up here telling you it's because of God. It's not because of their ability. It's because of God's power in their lives. And God wants to use you to do great things. If you go back to that verse there, what does it say? It says, but you will receive power. You've got to receive it. But you know what that means, though, is that that means you were created to receive that power. If God says you're going to be able to receive it, you're created to have it. You're a container for God's power. You know that's why you're here, why you're on this earth? God created you to fill you up with the power of God. And so you could work and do great things for His kingdom. And we limit ourselves, brother and sister. That's why you're here. Everybody's searching for their reason in life, why they're here, why they're on this earth. God created you to have a relationship with you and use you for His kingdom. And He gave you all the ability, all the skills, because it comes from God. You can do amazing things for Him. Yet we limit ourselves because we look at ourselves. We don't think we measure up. We don't think we do this or that. That's why you're here. I want to look at kind of further down the road here in Acts. In Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. So Jesus tells His disciples to wait for this Holy Spirit, this Comforter to come. So they go to this upper room, lock the door because they're scared of getting sent to prison. And they're waiting for what Jesus has promised. They're being obedient. And I want you to see what happens. On the day of Pentecost, all the believers were meeting together in one place. Suddenly, there was a sound from heaven like the roaring of a mighty windstorm, and it filled the house where they were sitting. Then what looked like flames of or tongues of fire appeared and settled on each of them. And everyone present, look at this, was filled with the Holy Spirit. That's what we just talked about, the power of the Holy Spirit coming on them, and began speaking in other languages as the Holy Spirit gave them this ability. And you heard it up here, I think Pastor Blaine said it. God's no respecter of persons. We're His disciples just as much as these disciples were up in the day of Pentecost. And you need to be waiting to receive that power of the Holy Spirit to come on you. And I hope you're looking for it. I hope you're ready for it. They were just being obedient and stepping out and waiting for what Jesus told them was going to happen. And if you look at the lives of the disciples up to this point, they were flopping around, doing all kinds of things. They do good things once and other things the other way. And they needed that power. They needed the Holy Spirit to come on them. And you guys are sitting here because they got empowered. Amen. Because they left out of that place. And it says right away 5,000 got saved. And they spread out to every corner of the globe. And God used them to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that's why we're here. Because of these 12, 13 guys, these other believers here. That's a pretty great thing, right? So a couple of quick fill-ins here. The old school church was filled with the Holy Spirit. We just read about that. Did we miss that one? We were created to house godly power. Sorry. Steaming ahead here. Thank you. So created, and then the old school church was filled with the Holy Spirit. God wants to fill us up. And that, you know, that word fill, it's just like not, you know, he's not going to do it halfway or partial or just give you just a little bit. No, he wants to fill you up. He wants to have your tank full with the power of the Holy Spirit. Now we see the old school church was led by the Holy Spirit. They went from man driving them to being led by the Holy Spirit. And I hope you allow, as you allow the Holy Spirit to fill you, you're going to be led by the Spirit. He's going to talk to you and tell you what to do. And you're going to be a lot more efficient and a lot more able to accomplish what God has for you if we're led. And the last thing, we've been talking about this, the old school church was empowered by the Holy Spirit. We all need to be empowered. Because again, we can't do it in our own strength, our own ability. I think most of us are fairly mature in here. You probably figured that out throughout your life. That's why you became a Christian. Because you realized you couldn't do it in your own strength. You couldn't earn your way to heaven. You couldn't rub two sticks together. You couldn't run down to Target and get the, you know, latest formula. No. You had to turn to Jesus Christ. You had to look to someone else to help you, to empower you, to be led. And that's what we've signed up for. I want to look at just the example of the Apostle Peter. Just really quick. You guys kind of know Peter's story. You know, he was the one that always put his foot in his mouth, and I gave him credit. He at least stepped out usually, but it was always kind of at his own strength, right? He jumped out of the boat and sank, right? And Jesus had to pick him up. I mean, he told Jesus that he walked for a little bit. He did. But he got his eyes on himself. He told Jesus, you know, he wasn't going to get crucified, and Jesus told him to, you know, get behind me, Satan. And he's always doing something, but it was a lot of it was himself. But you look at Peter's life after this happens, and there is a difference. There's a transformation in his life when he had the power of the Holy Spirit come on him. And I just want to share one thing that kind of happened right after this happened in Acts chapter 3. And just really quickly, the backstory of this is Peter and John go into the temple, into the church, and they're going to worship. And they pass by this guy who's lame, can't walk. And I'm sure, I guarantee you, they passed by him before. And every religious leader has passed by that guy before. And he's sat there without receiving anything, other than maybe a couple of coins here and there. But I want you to see what Peter says to him as he walks by this time. But Peter said, I have no silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. He realized he had something. He realized he had a power that wasn't himself. And there was a need that needed to be met. And God was going to meet that need. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And we know the rest of the story. This man rose up, walked, said, started leaping and praising God. He's running around, you know, like obviously all of us would if we're in that situation. And they couldn't do anything. They didn't know what to do with him. What a testimony. But how was Peter able to do that? Because he realized he had had revelation and he had been filled to the full with the Holy Spirit and the power of that Holy Spirit. So it wasn't Peter hadn't changed, but his inside had changed. His life had changed. How he carried himself. He wouldn't have done that back in the Gospels. Or he'd have jerked the guy up and, you know, the guy would have fell flat in his face. But he got empowered. And brother and sister, that's what's going to happen to us. If we allow ourselves to be filled, if we avail ourselves to that power. And we're almost done here. So you say, Pastor, how do we do that? How does this happen? It's not complex. It's something called faith. Faith. You've got to believe that God has that power and he's going to work in your life. That he's not going to fail you. He's going to come through in the moment of need. And like David and Liz said, it may not be how we figure everything out, but we need to have faith in God. That he wants to work with you. He wants to empower you. He wants to lead you. And he wants to fill you up with enough so you can go hit your Goliaths. Because you're going to have winds, you're going to have waves, you're going to have circumstances come against you. But we can be victorious over those. But we have to walk in faith on a daily, minute-by-minute basis. And that's, you know what? That's between you, me, and the fence post. That's hard to do. I've got to continue to battle that. I've got to continue to allow myself to have faith in God, to trust in God totally. Because you're going to have doubts. You're going to have, like they were talking about, you're going to have things come against you. The devil's going to be after you. Tell you you're not good enough. These circumstances are too overwhelming. They're too difficult for God. You go out and you figure it out in your own strength, in your own ability, in your own mind. No. We got to have faith in God. We got to be fully convinced that whatever comes our way, that God is big enough for us. And that I'm worthy to receive that. And he wants to pour it into me. God wants to empower you. He wants to do it in your life so you can walk in victory and have success. He didn't put us here to flop around or be failures, and there's no condemnation in Jesus Christ. Wherever you've been, let's go forward and see success, because God is with us. He is with us. He's real. You know, if you don't believe it, let's just go, because we're wasting our time here. But you know what? He is. And man, if we can grab hold and believe that, we can just do tremendous things. I'm fully, fully convinced that each one of you is so important to the body of Christ. Each one of you has a tremendous part to play. You're created to do great things for Christ. And that's not some preacher up here telling you that. That's what the Word of God says. And you can believe it, because God is bigger. Ephesians 6:10, the same word. Paul is talking to the Ephesians. It says, finally, be strong. That's the same dunamis power in the Lord and in his mighty power. That verse could be translated. Listen to this. Be infused with supernatural strength and ability. Be empowered with his special touch of God's strength. Receive his inner strengthening. I'd sign up for all that. That's what I need. I don't know about you. So really quickly, we're just almost done here. Let me give you the last fill-in so I don't forget them. Let's stretch out in faith and become infused with the power of the Holy Spirit. You got to take courage. You got to have faith. You got to step out and trust God. Wherever you're at, whatever God's calling you to do, it's all different for all of us. But God wants you to stretch out in faith. And again, that's something we got to work on. It's like a muscle. You got to keep working on it. Make it strong. Keep putting your faith out there. Keep believing God. And God will infuse you with the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. Why don't you stand? We're going to have the worship team come back. I want to do three things. First thing I'm going to do is just pray. If you've never received Jesus Christ as your Heavenly Father, as your Savior, we're going to pray for that. And for all the rest of us, I'm going to have you come forward. We're not going to lay hands on you or anything, but I want you to come to the altar. And we're going to believe to be filled with the Holy Spirit and His power. Then the last thing is, those of you who got your tithes and offerings together, I speak a blessing over that right now in Jesus' name. And give on your way out. The ushers will be at the doors. And please join us next door for fellowship, coffee and donuts and good eats. Because we want to continue to have that family. Because we love each other. So we believe right now, if you've never received Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, today's the day. We're believing that lives are going to be changed. If you've never made that choice to accept what Jesus Christ did for you by coming as God on this earth and being nailed to the cross and dying in place of us for our sins and going down to hell and rising victorious so we can have eternal life with Him. It's really just a choice. You just got to choose and say, okay, you know what? I do believe that Jesus is real, that He died and He rose again. And I commit my life to Him because of what He did for me. He loved you first. He chose you. And we just got to make that choice to choose Him. And just take a minute to do that in your heart.
After every teaching, we'd like to give you an opportunity to act on the Word of God. And the most important application you could ever make is asking Jesus Christ to be your own Lord and Savior. It's kind of like giving the driving wheel over to Him and say, you start driving now. I want your plan and your purpose in my life. But that needs that I need to personally ask Him to come in. And the way you do that is the same for all of us. All of us in it the same way. You believe Jesus is real. You believed He walked the earth. He was a real man, the Son of God, Son of Man. He walked the earth for 33 years, but He went to the cross. Why the cross? To pay the penalty for your sin and my sin. We couldn't pay it, but He did. 3 days in the belly of the earth, but then He rose. Resurrection, to break the power of sin so you and I can enter into what's called eternal life. And so I want you to do that today, because that's a tug you're feeling in your heart. So just pray this simple prayer with me. Say, Father, in Jesus' name, I receive You as my Lord and Savior. I ask You to come into my life. I give You my life. I want Your purposes, not mine, in Jesus' name. Now, if you said that simple prayer, it happened to you. It's done. So contact us so we can send you materials and help you in this journey. scf.org. That's our website. Then hit contact and give us the information so we can all rejoice together. Now walk in His victory.